the title of my presentation is Pangolin Species Lost, Millions of Opportunity Lost. Pangolin, also known as the scaly ants, are unique creatures that are covered in high late life cells. They are insectivorous, that is, they eat insects, and they are found in Africa and Asia. They are predominantly nocturnal, that is, they move around at night. They are very secretive, and the name pangolin comes from the Malay word meaning to roll up. And those of you Yoruba indigenous here, the name in Yoruba is called Akika or Aka, which simply means to roll up as well. Now, there are 8 pangolin species in the world. 4 found in Asia, 4 found in Africa. Now, the Malaysian pangolin and the Chinese pangolin are regarded as endangered. We'll come to why and how that has come about later in the presentation. Despite protection by law, they are still threatened by habitat loss and illegal trade for their meat and unique skills for use in traditional medicine. Now, as I mentioned, the pangolin have scales, and these scales have been one of the things that has led to its crucifixion, if I should use that word, because a lot of people go about thinking that that scale, which is the same material as my fingernails and hair, can cure ailments. The four pangolin species found in Africa include the African white-bellied pangolin, which is what you are looking at here. The white belly is very pronounced in this species. Then we have the giant pangolin. Now up here you see near threatened. Then you have the cape pangolin, and then the long-tailed pangolin. The long-tailed pangolin is such that the length of its tail is twice that of its body. So it gives it that unique look. And the tail is used for climbing. Now, all African pangolin species are listed as vulnerable in recently revised red data list of endangered species by IUCN. Kids. IUCN means International Union of the Conservation of Nature. So you take note of that. Now, I have come to explain to people that the vulnerable status of the giant pangolin should be changed to endangered in Africa. Why? In a recent survey carried out during the annual hunt, this is a photograph of the annual hunt, all these farmers, all these hunters here, all the hunters, all the ones under age 25, had never seen the giant pangolin. The giant pangolin in Yoruba is called Akairin, and it's described as big, being as big as a trailer tire. That is big, and it's an animal that has a lot of meat around it, because if you encounter it at night, approaching you, you think somebody is coming with a rattler. You know what a rattler is? You know what a rattler is? Don't tell me mommy didn't give you a rattler when you're growing up. What's a rattler? This little toy that small children shake. Shekere, woro. That's how the giant pangolin sounds. All the people under 25 among all these hunters have never seen a giant pangolin, which by my own criteria qualifies it as being endangered. Now, the four pangolins found in Asia are the Indian pangolin, Philippine pangolin, Malaysian pangolin, Chinese pangolin. And as I've said, they've already declared the Malaysian pangolin and Chinese pangolin as being endangered, while the Indian pangolin and Philippine pangolin are characterized as being near threatened. Now, some people believe, because of their weird look, you saw the first photograph of the pangolin, that they are related to anteaters, sloths, or armadillo. But I tell it to you that they are wrong, because from research done by Texas A&M University's biology department, they say the pangolin is related to our bingo and our pussycat. So they are more related to dogs, cats, bears. That is, they are what? I can't hear you, kids. Mammals, yes, but they are carnivorous. They are carnivorous. So, now, according to the International Union of Conservation of Nature, virtually no information is available on population level of any species of pangolin. These species are rarely observed due to their secretive, solitary, and nocturnal habits. And this has there has been little research on their population density. But we thank God, next door to us here in IITA, you can see this photograph here, courtesy Danny Brown, the head of IITA Forest Unit. This pangolin was seen in IITA. So telling you that we still have some respite in studying the pangolin in situ as it is. Now, but it is obvious that all species are in decline, most especially in Africa, due to high human population density, ineffective enforcement of hunting laws, the bushmeat trade, together with habitat destruction and fragmentation. These are some of the problems that wildlife is facing in Africa. Now, you see my brother here with his gun. Nobody's controlling what he hunts. And those who have associations to control don't have the enforcement power, that is the power to enforce those regulations among themselves. And then those who are in the government sector to regulate it can't go about in the bush at night. So we're having a lot of problems with hunting. Now, I can't say you should stop building houses. This place was once a very forested area, but now you can't even find a single tree there. We've all cleared and built our houses. We must talk with our architects and developers to know how to improve the method of development such that they include biodiversity consideration in their development. Now, the International Union IUCN Species Survey there's a group, Pangolin Specialist Group. Now, they've declared that pangolins are now the most illegally trained mammals in the world. Now, this photograph you are seeing here, these are not grains of sand. These are pangolins. You can imagine the number of pangolins in this pile. These ones were seized in Asia. Now, with more than 1 million individuals believed to have been snatched from the wild over the past decade. That's a lot. And we are depleting the population of pangolin in the wild too fast. Now, despite national and international conventions and laws that protect pangolins, they are constantly hunted for bushmeat as well as traditional medical purposes in all countries in Africa where they occur, and most recently traded in large volumes to Asia. Now, if we just look at the bushmeat trade, we can say we are the ones consuming it. Although some people are already exporting it. We are now having an involvement of Asian countries, most especially China, who wants the scales of pangolin for traditional medicine and in large volumes. Now, here you see a truck filled with pangolin. This was seized to somewhere. And here you see bags full of scales of pangolin. Here you see already packaged pangolin scales for the traditional medical practitioners. Now, some people believe if you mix the scales of pangolin with urine, it will cure ailments. Now, you young ones here, can you eat your nail and get cured of stomach ache? So, please try and tell the adults that eating scales from pangolin will not solve their problems. Can you eat your hair and solve problem with your leg ache? So you know better. So tell daddy and mommy that pangolin scales will not solve their ailments. It's the same material that you have in your nails and your hair that makes up the pangolin scales. Now, recently, faraway Singapore, a shipment of illegal ivory and pangolin scales worth $1.3 million was seized. Now, that means in the packet we had 205 pieces of raw ivory. Do we know what ivory are? The two guys using glasses like me. Do you know what ivory is? Two of you. Yes, you know what ivory is? Okay. Ivory is the material that makes up the tusk of the elephants. And how many tusks does an elephant have?
Two.
So now, quickly calculate how many elephants have been killed to get 255. Let's have the chicken obese and the profs of mathematics here. Yes? 510. No. You have to divide this by 2. Yes? 124 plus 1. That means 125 elephants had been slaughtered, murdered, taken away from the wild to get this. And look at how big an elephant is. They would have left the carcass in the bush there to rot. Are we that heartless? Huh? So we have to do something about this kind of thing. Now we have 505 kilograms of pangolin scales. The pangolin is about 1 kilogram. That's the small one. And the big one, the elephant and the archaeary, that pangolin is about, give or take, 55 kg. Now, and most of its body is made of the scale. Now, 1.5, and you have 505. That means you have over 500 pangolins slaughtered just to get their scales out. For somebody to drink magic potion with, which doesn't work except in Harry Potter films. Now, let's come to the pangolins we have in Africa. This is what did I call this one? This is the giant pangolin, and that's the white-bellied pangolin. Pangolin species vary from size from about 1.6 kg to a maximum of 33 kg. They vary in color from light to yellow brown, through olive to dark brown. Now, we've mentioned that they are covered in scales. Now, I have something in my pocket which I would like you to pass around. It will give you a feel of what the pangolin is like. Can I have somebody? Now, that is just what you can explain, how you can explain the pangolin scale. The way it overlaps and protects the animal. Now, the edge of the scales are sharp. And this is brought about by digging burrows. Unlike African pangolin, the Asian pangolins also have thick bristles that emerge from between their scales. That's how you can tell them apart. That's the ones in Africa and Asia. Now, pangolins are so unique. They don't have teeth, but they have a very long tongue that is longer than their own length. So in this slide, you can see the tongue of the pangolin is sticking out. Can you see it? And you see it here. So they use that tongue to lap insects. They don't have teeth to chew. So you can't have a situation where a pangolin bites somebody. And because of the length, it can go deep into termiterium. That is a lot of termites, right? And anteaters to get its food. Now, pangolins have poor vision, so locate termite and ants nest with their strong sense of smell. A pangolin's tongue is attached near its pelvis and part of its rib, and when fully extended, is longer than the animal's head and body. At rest, a pangolin's tongue retracts into a sheath in its chest cavity. Now, a pangolin's stomach is made of muscle and has keratinous spines projecting into its interior. Now, who can give me an example of something that has such a stomach? You can see there is likened to the gizzard of the chicken. So that's how the pangolin's stomach is It has stones inside, small, small stones, that it uses to grind the insect that it eats. Now, pangolin limbs are stout and well adapted for digging. Each paw has 5 toes, and their 4 foot have 3 long curved claws used to pull back of trees, demolish the nest of termites and ants, and to dig sleeping and nesting burrows. Now, you can see the claws here. This log here was seen in IITA with the proof that pangolins have been there. With this kind of claws, you will definitely leave an indention wherever you walk with it, right? So, wherever you see logs being ripped like this and you see 3 claw marks in it, that tells you that pangolin is around. I've been around other places, other forest areas in Ibadan, to come about any proof that pangolin is available is very hard. So to see it in IITA is a major plus. Now, pangolins are capable of swimming, and while some pangolin species such as the African ground pangolin are completely terrestrial, others such as the African tree pangolin are adapted using their claws and tails to grip and climb trees. You can see this one here. This photograph was taken in Port Harcourt area, Cross River State rather, sorry, Cross River State. And you can see the pangolin there climbing the tree. Now, pangolins are, they reach sexual maturity after 2 years, and their gestation period is between 65 to 150 days, depending on the species. And the young ones are born 8 to 450 grams, and the scales are not as deeply colored, they are lightly colored. The young ones usually are weaned after 3 months. And pangolin is the only mammal that carries its young one on its back, on its tail rather. So you can see the adult pangolin there, and where is it carrying the young one? On the tail. So this is very unique to pangolin. Pangolins are found in a variety of habitats, including tropical and flooded forests, thick bushes, cleared and cultivated areas, and savanna grasslands. In general, they occur where large numbers of ants and termites are found. That is, if we have not finished hunting them, persecuting them. Pangolin dig deep burrows for sleeping and nesting. Now, they have circular chambers, and some chambers have been discovered to be as big as, give or take, 5 feet, where a fully grown man can stand. So they are very good diggers. And then you can have some pangolins in trees, like the Malaysian pangolin and the African tree pangolin. They dig holes in trees, and then you can see them sleeping in tree pots. Now, you can see the tree here. This is a river, and then this area is pangolins have been sighted. I will give the location so that they won't go and hunt them. Now, pangolin scales provide good defense against predators. When threatened, the pangolin will quickly curl up into a ball, protecting their defenseless underside. Now, at times, they protect themselves by making a hissing sound or using flicking their tail, the sharp edge, at predators. Now, as I mentioned, they depend on their sense of smell to get around, and they use urine and feces to mark their territories. And the diet of pangolin contains mainly of ants and termites, which they may supplement with various other invertebrates, including bee, larva, flies, worms, earthworms, and crickets. As a result of their specialist diet, it's very difficult to maintain them in captivity. They often reject unfamiliar insect species or become ill when fed foreign food. While pangolin locate their insects using a well-developed sense of smell. Because of this character, it's very hard to keep them in zoos. So once you lock them up, it's like a death sentence to them. So they are best left in situ, that is, in their habitats. And we have to work out ways of studying them like that, not bringing them to our zoos or to our laboratories to study, except we want to do what some of us call postmortem. Now, they are voracious insect eaters, and they've been known to consume as many as 70 million insects in a year. So that is a very significant job that they do in the ecosystem. They are very good at pest control. So the average pangolin will eat 70 million insects in a year. And they have special muscles in their eyes, ears, and nostrils to prevent insects from getting into them. Now, the International Union of Conservation of Nature Red List has, as I mentioned, it's a comprehensive information source on global conservation status of animals, fungi, and plant species. And they are linked to livelihood far more than a list of species and their status. It is a powerful tool to inform and crystallize information of biodiversity conservation and policy change, critical to protection, to protecting the natural resources we need to survive. Now, we have policymakers here. The importance of the Red List is highlighted here, so that we know the conservation status of each organism out there, trees, fungi, and as we said, the pangolin is characterized as being vulnerable in Africa. And I go further to characterize the giant pangolin as already being endangered. Now, they've used this criteria. You have extinct, threatened, low risk. Under extinct, you have extinct completely, as we have in the passenger pigeon in the US. We have the extinct in the wild, as we have in the giant turtle, where we have only two left in the world. So we are not doing very well in this end. Then we have the critically endangered, we have the endangered, the vulnerable, we have the near threatened, conservation dependent, and least concerned. Now, the Red List is, they have a criteria which basically depends on what scientists provide. That is the amount of this animal that has been recorded in the wild, the amount that has been recorded through questionnaires, data collection, collation, and analysis. With that, they come up with the Red List. Now, according to IUCN, the formula, the formally stated goal of the Red List are to provide scientific basis-based information on the status of species and subspecies at a global level, to draw attention to the magnitude and importance of threatened biodiversity, to influence national and international policies and decision making, to provide information to guide actions to conserve biological diversity. Now, all African pangolin species are listed as vulnerable in recently revised Red List of endangered species, implying that African pangolins are now at high risk of endangerment in the wild. Now, biodiversity is the uniqueness and variety of species and ecosystem. The rich variety of life forms in nature. Now, life forms include human beings. We are not an advanced species. No, we all belong to this web of life. And if we don't take care and we continue having extinctions coming place, we will be the next to go extinct. You can see the big elephants, the the small bats, the ground squirrel, the birds, the flowers, the butterflies, all of us, we need each other to survive on Earth. Now, science, because of our biased nature, we tend to categorize some animals over the other. Take for example, the big five. We have the elephant, the lion, the rhinoceros, the hippopotamus, and the leopard. People tend to look at them as being important. But I tell it to you that every animal is important. That is why we have this day, the World Pangolin Day, to explain to us that, yes, the pangolin, though small, is very important. Now, in the year 2006, large numbers of eight species were formally classified as rare or endangered or threatened species. Moreover, many scientists have estimated that there are millions more species actually endangered which have not yet been formally recognized. About 40% of the 4017 species assessed using IUCN Red List criteria are now listed as threatened species with extinction. That is a total of 16119 species. Since Stone Age, species loss have been accelerated above the geological rate by human activities. That is the bushmeat trade and then the tradomedical trade. The rate of species extinction is difficult to estimate, but it has been established that species are now being lost at a rate approximately 100 times as fast as typical in the geological record, or perhaps as high as 10,000 times as fast. To feed the present land population in the world, more land is being transformed for wildlifeness, from wilderness with wildlife into agricultural, mining and lumbering and urban areas for humans. Now, we now come to why species are important and we don't have to risk them getting extinct. Biodiversity and the ecosystem goods and services it provides are considered to be fundamental to healthy ecosystem. The loss of biodiversity is increasingly recognized as a significant risk factor in business development and a threat to long-term economic sustainability. Now, if you look at rural areas, some of them, they can't afford the chickens we buy in urban areas. So if we completely eradicate the wildlife, we put them at risk. And then it is said that environmental poverty is worse than financial poverty, in that you can always bounce back from financial poverty. But if you are environmentally compromised, it can be impossible to get back. I'll give you an example. Now, you have a situation where a community depends on honey for survival. If people go about spraying insecticides and all the bee population in that place die, what happens? Their honey business collapses. And before the environment bounces back, it can take generations. So a community that exists on honey will have a lot of problems. But as of now, we see what's happening in Nigeria. The oil collapse. Now, we've been here before, and the country bounced back. So we can still get out of financial poverty. But when it comes to environmental poverty, we can't bounce back. Now, this explains that in the past, give or take 20 years or 25 years, a lot of effort has been going into developing chemicals for treatment in the pharmaceutical industry, but they've not gone anywhere. Now, we have a lot of plants and animals that can provide treatment. We know of the chloroquine. We got it from quinine. The same thing in some some of these animals and trees which we are running down because of our greed to feed and then lack of understanding. If we don't take time to understand these animals and we lose them, most especially the pangolin, it is gone for life. Now, an interesting point is that evolved DNA embodies knowledge, and therefore destroying a species resembles burning a book with all the information of the book. So if we lose a species, it's like those of you who like reading books. You go to a library, you plan to come back tomorrow to read some books, and the library is burnt down. You can't read the book, you can't get information in that book, it is lost for life. The same thing happens when we lose species, and the loss of the pangolin can result into that, because we don't still understand the pangolin. I mentioned earlier on that very little research has been done because into its behavior, its ecology, because of its nocturnal and secretive life. Now, rural communities all over Africa are historically dependent on exploration of natural resources, most especially wildlife, as a primary source of protein, and they have hunted sustainably for generations. For most people living in the forest, bushmeat is one of the few sources of protein available, along with catching local fishes. The loss of such easy catch as the pangolin will be depriving this community of their basic nutritional needs, contributing to disease risk, especially when immune systems are depressed, and raising long-term food security concern. Now, that tells you that we have to take steps to protect and prevent undue exploitation of our wildlife. Now, the relationship between the natural areas are, now this tells you that when you domesticate an animal, you lose some traits. But that loss, right, is not enough to warrant not taking action to protecting this animal. Now, a family, part of what the wildlife provides is recreation. After this second program now, we'll all go to the zoo to see the wildlife in there. And you have situations where people can go into parks. So these are some of the things that wildlife provide. And if we lose them, we lose such things. We should note that the stability of ecosystem is related to biodiversity, with higher biodiversity producing greater stability over time, and reducing the chance that ecosystem service will be disrupted as a result of disturbance, such as extreme weather events or human exploration. And it should be noted that extinction of key species, such as the pangolin, threatens irreversible ecological changes. The loss of the pangolin will imply that the millions of insects consumed by the animal will be left in the ecosystem to cause crop and other damages. Pangolin in sustainable appetite for insects give them an important role in the ecosystem as very good pest control. Now, the way forward: education, manpower development, capacity building, provision of alternative sources of livelihood, and then enforcement of conservation laws. Now, the sustainable commercial harvesting of Africa's wildlife is the singular greatest threat to Africa's biodiversity. It has very rapidly eradicated almost all the large mammals from unprotected areas in West Africa, and threatened to do so, to do the same in the next 20 years in Central Africa. As this occurs, species of which the public in Europe and United States express particular concern, such as the elephant, lion, and the great apes are also put at great risk. Now, this is the Debbie Ellen. It used to be abundant a long time ago. Now, I don't think anybody has seen the Debbie Ellen in the forest in recent time. It can grow bigger than a cow. Now, these are elephants in Yakari. They are sources of income in areas of ecotourism. So, if we lose them, that source of income is lost. One of the main ways that people in Africa use wildlife is for food, as I've mentioned earlier, and it is therefore going to have to be one of the key issues integrated into conservation policies in order to promote the preservation of species to Africa. Sustainable harvesting of some species is going to have to be allowed in conjunction with animal husbandry schemes. A breeding program of wild animals has turned the wild into domesticated animal, which on the long run changes the authorities relating to its management. Now, what we are trying to put together here is that yes, you cannot completely eradicate bushmeat trade, but we can modify it. The universities have done research into wildlife that have now been used in farms, that is domestication. You have the grass cutter, you have the guinea fowl. These animals can be reintroduced into some areas where they will be well managed, so that hunters can come once in a while to hunt for the bushmeat trade, and then you can have culling taking place such that you have these animals prepared for the bushmeat industry. Some school of thought, they say that this type of practice introduces a genetic erosion or variation which would invariably influence meat production. The need to stimulate the rural economy through wildlife breeding program to promote food security for the ever-growing population in Africa is more important and outweighs any indemnity of this practice. That's my own personal opinion. So please, the researchers here, don't hang me for it. But I think these are areas we should all look into. Now, in Gabon, 18 million kilograms of bushmeat are traded every year with an estimated turnover of 50 million euros. According to the write-up, that is 2% of the country's non-oil GDP. Now, something that can produce 50 million euros cannot be thrown to the dogs. These are areas where our policymakers should make efforts so that we tap into it. Now we have problems with oil. If our bushmeat industry can grow with adequate monitoring, we can have this fund in our setup. I know in Ghana, they have sustainable harvesting methods for the pet industry, where they go and take pythons, put them in enclosures. When they breed, they take the young ones for the pet markets. These areas can be explored. Now, in order to achieve food security through bushmeat production, Africa has to engage in active capacity development in terms of training the trainers in the improvement of rural economy to stimulate rapid economic growth, poverty alleviation, and political stability within the continent. You can see here, the University of Badon is trying a lot with their Department of Wildlife and Ecotourism Management in capacity building. Now, include conservation education in the National Program of Public Enlightenment. It said that education is the key to promoting proper care and respect for our biodiversity. The future of our environment lies in the hands of the next generation. An old saying goes, we do not own any land. We are merely looking after it for our children. By making future generations aware of the pressure on the natural world, we can help to decrease the destruction our generation is now just realizing. A good basic education is as essential to people's need as clean air and water, for without it, individuals are robbed of their ability to make sound choice for their future perspective. Now, you all know better that eating your nails and your hair will not cure stomach ache or leg ache. That is because of the education you are being given. So go out and teach people. That is why we have such a day to enlighten about what should be done in protecting the environment. Now, supporting community conservation programs as well as promoting representation of rural community in monitoring of existing wildlife conservation program, putting in place mechanisms to involve the authorized local population as resource managers in decision making and wildlife resource management operations, while allocating substantial percentage of revenue accrued to from wildlife management to local communities, encouraging and supporting activities of organized private sector and non-governmental organizations involved in wildlife resource conservation efforts, and giving national recognition to successful conservation initiatives at local level. Now, this we have the Hunters Union. They are supposed to be represented here. They have a very good check and balance mechanism in them. But if it is not recognized, they have problem in enforcing their laws, because they say not everybody that carries a gun to go hunting belongs to the union. So if such union are strengthened, it helps control their activities, because they know when to go into the bush and when not to go into the bush. Now, protected areas will have to incorporate local conservation knowledge and modern information technology techniques in their management practice. Enforcement agencies must get involved in massive enlightenment, proper intelligence gathering, by collaborating with each other, as well as international law enforcement agencies and civil societies involved in wildlife conservation to tackle the ills of wildlife crime. Now we have the Park Service, NESRIA, the police, Custom, Interpol. Most of the time they are acting independent of each other. So we must have a situation where they collaborate. NESRIA is supposed to be the enforcement agency. The Park Service is supposed to be the ones protecting the animals in protected areas. Yet you see people go into the protected areas, take out animals, bypass NESRIA, bypass police, bypass Custom, and end up in Singapore with our elephant tusk and Pangolin scales. That is because they are not working together well. Now you have a situation where in Asia, they have photographs of their tigers. Recently, a tiger skin was seized from somebody after the death of a tiger in a protected area. And it was proved by photograph that it was the tiger in the protected area that was poached, helping prosecution of this person. That is ICT. We can have a situation where some of our animals will be fitted with GPS. We have the phone companies. We have cellular chips that can be put into these animals for management. So we must look into how to include ICT. We have young, brilliant programmers who can come up with programs so that if an animal is missing from a protected area, it crosses a particular barrier, an alarm goes off in all these offices, and they're able to track whoever is committing the crime. So we all have to work together to help protect this wildlife. Now, as far back as 1961, Julius Nyerere in the Arusha Declaration said this. He The survival of our wildlife is a matter of grave concern to all of us in Africa. These wild creatures, amid the wild places they inhabit, are not only important as a source of wonder and inspiration, but are an integral part of our natural resource and of our future livelihood and well-being. So, if as far as 1961, one of our leaders had said this, present crop of leaders should take a cue from this and see how we can put things in place so that we don't completely deplete Africa of its wildlife. Now, I tell people, the pharaohs in Egypt were not conquered by barbarians. It was the environment that conquered them, because they were cutting trees and using animals in their potions and coal without due consideration of the environment, building pyramids. So the desert came, and the pharaohs, they lost hold of Egypt. Now, we all have this write-up. It's a poem that I wrote, and I always like reciting in functions like this. So I think I would like all the kids to join me in reciting this, so that we send a message to us, the older ones, about what we should do about our environment. So, can we all stand up, please? Can we all stand up, please? Only. So, out to our daddies, mommies, uncles, aunties. Are we all together? Are we all ready? So, we read. In the days of old,
thank you for that beautiful presentation. We thank you for the lecture.